While we are here at the New York Times, I would like to start with some facts, because there are probably very few people that appreciate the art of getting to the facts quickly as much as journalists. So let's begin with three numbers that are important for the discussions that you will be having today. The first number is 3.9 billion. This represents the total number of people who now live in cities throughout the world. It's more than half of our global population, and it is increasing rapidly, especially in Asia and Africa. The second number is 70%. UN Habitat tells us that cities account for around 70% of all global emissions. In other words, the majority of all greenhouse gases released into the atmosphere comes from places like here, New York City. The final number is 1.5 degrees. This is the big number. The Paris Climate Change Agreement of 2015 states we must stay below a 2 degrees Celsius temperature rise and as close to 1.5 degrees as possible over pre-industrial levels. The last number depends on the first two, making it abundantly clear we cannot address climate change in any real and meaningful way unless cities are a key part of the process. We need your help, because when it comes to addressing climate change, we no longer have the luxury of time. Never has the need for action been more obvious or evident. As Anne was saying, the recent hurricanes that devastated parts of the Americas have left us horrified, heartbroken, and my heart goes out to those who have lost family, friends, and futures. We must never forget that behind each of these events are real people and real suffering. Their losses are enormous, and so is our compassion for them. The memory of Hurricane Sandy is still, I'm sure, fresh in the minds of many here in New York City. As UN Secretary General Guterres recently pointed out, natural disasters have quadrupled in number since 1970, and the United States has experienced the most disasters since 1995. We're seeing torrential rains in India, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Africa has experienced some of the worst flooding since 2012 in countries such as Niger, Nigeria, and Sierra Leone. In no strange coincidence, NASA recently reported a sobering statistic that the first 6 months of 2017 were the second hottest first 6 year calendar months on record, and the hottest year, 2016. The oceans are warming, polar regions are melting, and extreme weather is increasing. When I say we are in a battle against time, I'm not exaggerating. We simply must act before it's too late. We must understand this, just like everybody understands that the parachute cord has to be pulled before you hit the ground. The consequences of not acting quickly enough will have an enormous impact everywhere, but especially in our cities. More than two-thirds of the world's megacities sit in coastal regions. 8% of people living there reside within 100 kilometers of the coast. As sea level rise, these cities are at risk. Right here in New York City, this is a reality. This includes the most basic needs of their citizens, food, water, energy, sanitation, as well as their economies. Climate change, of course, is linked to other social issues. Shifts in climate can lead to crop damage and clean water shortages, which can lead to conflicts over resources. It affects poverty and education levels, along with malnutrition and disease. That's why it is so important that at roughly the same time as we reached the Paris Climate Agreement, nations also agreed to a suit of what are called the Sustainable Development Goals. Together, they represent a new path forward and a new vision for the future. To date, more than 160 countries have ratified the Paris Agreement, and it was brought into force 4 years ahead of schedule. And I do want to underline this. People thought the Paris Agreement will come in force in 2020. No, it came in force in less than a year after it was agreed in Paris. It was one of the most important multilateral success stories ever. Unfortunately, the era of implementation of the agreement is now underway. As you know, we will continue to work in defining the operational manual of the agreement in our next conference of the parties to be held in Bonn, Germany, under the presidency of Fiji in November this year. This will be the first time that a small island developing state is going to preside over such a big conference, a conference that brings together almost 25,000 people every year and has become, therefore, the biggest UN conference that is held yearly. At the same time as this great coming together of nations, we're also seeing a rising wave of commitment to action from cities, regions, states, business, investors, and civil society. Here in the United States, California just strengthened its commitment to reducing greenhouse gas emissions. They are targeting 100% renewable energy by 2045. And as the New York Times pointed out in an editorial recently, the 9 northeastern states that form the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative are also boosting action. They've agreed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from power plants an additional 30% by 2030. This is on top of the 40% cut they have already achieved since the program began in 2009. These states have achieved substantial emissions reductions at little cost to their economies or to their consumers. As the article shows, electricity rates have fallen by an average of 3.5% in the 9 states. At the city level, New York City recently committed more than $100 million to implement a Cool Neighborhoods program. Los Angeles is also aiming to significantly reduce their urban heat totals over 20 years by establishing strong cool roofing requirements. We see similar coordinated action throughout the world. The Marrakesh Partnership for Global Climate Action represents coalitions of thousands of cities, regions, companies, and investors from around the world. They've come together to make voluntary commitments to support the implementation of ambitious action. We see it in China with the Low Carbon City Initiative, which aims to improve energy efficiency in their industry, construction, and transportation sectors. We're also seeing it in cities such as Delhi, where they've developed a comprehensive climate action plan that will connect with other cities to spur even more action. Finally, we also see it in cities such as Athens, Barcelona, and Paris, which have not only mapped their urban heat, but also their vulnerable populations. Together, they are working to ensure their citizens have access to cool places on hot days. Ladies and gentlemen, I know the power of cities. I come from one of the biggest in the world, and I'm very pleased to greet Mayor Mancera, my hometown, of which I'm extremely proud, and I want to congratulate him for everything he's doing in this regard. So while I understand jurisdiction complexity, I know that cities are where citizens are most directly connected to their governments. It's where people have the most influence and where we can communicate most effectively. With this in mind, let me turn now to 3 ways that I feel cities can do even more to contribute to our global climate goals, their country's climate plan, and their own sustainable futures. The first thing that cities can do is incorporate climate change into what they are doing right now. From infrastructure to finance to procurement, the opportunities are endless. This includes expanding transit to include electric buses, as we've seen in the UN climate change host city of Bonn in Germany, or making buildings more efficient by using sustainable material, just as we're seeing in many cities in India. On the finance front, making resilient infrastructure investments, growing green bond options, and helping to establish stable, clean energy markets are also important ways cities can contribute. And I am sure that today you will hear a lot of experiences around the world, and we in climate change, UN climate change, look forward also to hearing from that and to giving it as much visibility as possible. Second, cities must incorporate climate change and sustainability into their future planning. If cities can assess the impacts of climate change and sustainability and then incorporate these threats into planning, growth is going to become smarter and more sustainable. This just makes sense. It's proactive instead of reactive, and it's going to drive both innovation and a dynamic economy. Third, cities must communicate with citizens about climate change in ways that matter to them. Lack of knowledge and the assumption that it's very difficult to contribute are perhaps the greatest roadblocks we face when it comes to tackling climate change. Let's then open a dialogue with people about what matters to them. Let's face it, people are less concerned about the intricacies of climate policy than they are with how those policies affect their jobs, their health, and their families. You can just hit people over the head with doom and gloom, nor will moralizing motivate them to action. They must clearly understand how climate change will benefit them personally. They need to hear and read more stories about how resilient and better prepared cities are going to be not only safer, cleaner, and healthier for themselves and their families, but how these cities are where 21st century business will want to be. These will be businesses bearing jobs, good jobs, jobs that are also resilient for the future. An example, according to Forbes, the fastest growing job in America right now is a wind turbine technician. It is growing at a rate of 108% with a median wage of almost $50,000 per year. The electric car market is also about to enter its boom years. The list of auto companies focusing on electric is now longer than the ones who aren't. Solar energy, much the same. The publication Better Business, Better World recently reported that putting the sustainable development goals at the heart of the world's economic strategy could open up $12 trillion of opportunities and increase employment by up to 380 million jobs by 2030. This includes critical economic sectors such as energy, health, and urban growth. Ladies and gentlemen, as Secretary General Guterres said recently, the sustainability train has left the station. The business that will define the 21st century know it, and many cities throughout the world know it as well. We need even more cities on board. We need more cities to become part of the climate change progress and for all of them to increase their ambition and to help their national governments meet their climate goals and shape up and give content to the letter of the Climate Change Convention, its Kyoto Protocol, and the Paris Agreement. As I have outlined today, while cities represent some of our biggest challenges when it comes to addressing climate change, nowhere are people more prepared to capture some of its most important opportunities. So I encourage you to continue with your valuable efforts. I thank you for your commitment, for showing the way to others, and we in UN Climate Change stand ready to support you in any way we can. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you for everything you do every day.